Never underestimate the impact of a spectacular entrance. Greetings, I'm Oran O'Brien and I'm a BDM based out of our Melbourne office. I wanted to use this session to talk about the importance of negotiation in sales, in business, as well as in your career. The essential skills to getting ahead in the workplace, hard work, being an effective communicator, and a generous helping of good luck, they all play a role. Something else that's often overlooked is the ability to recognize and capitalize on opportunities to negotiate for your future career success. This doesn't just apply to sales, say, and the ability to negotiate a potential piece of work with a customer. It's just as relevant to each and every person at Servian, regardless of your role. In the workplace, it'll help you achieve long-term career success, boost productivity, and reduce workplace conflicts. In your personal life, being an effective negotiator will boost your creative and reasoning abilities, make it more difficult for people to take advantage of you, and make you a better strategizer. From a work perspective, let's say, for example, you've spent all your time on AWS engagements over a number of years, and the thought of another business stakeholder asking you about the benefits of Redshift versus Snowflake has you throwing up in your mouth. The customer may be keen to keep you, the team see the benefit of you being there. At the same time, you're keen to get your teeth into some new technologies. You've been upskilling in your own time. How do you approach that conversation? What's the best way of making that happen? How proactive do you need to be? Who do you need to convince? And how hard do you want to push your agenda? That's the nub of it. That's negotiation. And these are the sorts of things I'll be looking to explore over these next few slides. Thing is, your role in Servian is almost constantly up for negotiation, meaning the importance of negotiation in business as well as your career can't be overestimated. Rest assured, I'm not going to keep this purely theoretical. Later on, I'm going to jump into a particular negotiation-themed case study, something I was involved in, and fingers crossed it resonates. Not specific to Servian at all, it's got nothing to do with work, but hopefully in the next few minutes, I'll get you thinking, get you into a negotiating mindset, and you'll see certain learnings getting put into practice in a real world scenario. Remember though, and it's something I've noticed in this slide, it's not as if all's fair when traversing this process. It's not as if we invariably come out with an equal slice of the pie, because quite often there's a power disparity. From what I've seen in my career to date, there are certain characteristics that lend themselves well to negotiating successfully. We'll touch upon some of those over the next while. I found it interesting putting it together, and I really hope you guys get something out of it too. There's loads of books out there on negotiation. Getting to Yes, Never Splitting the Difference, and Bargaining for Advantage. But today, I'll be putting a fair bit of time focusing on one particular aspect of it, and that's emotion. Negotiation is a topic that is guaranteed to raise emotions. For many people, just thinking about an upcoming negotiation will increase anxiety, to say nothing of how we feel when we are physically slap bang in the center of an actual negotiation. Stakes are often high, and invariably, we have a personal interest in the outcome. Until around 20 years ago, few researchers paid much attention to the role of emotions in negotiating, how feelings can influence the way people overcome conflict, reach agreement, and create value when dealing with another party. Instead, the focus would invariably land on strategy and tactics, particularly the ways in which parties can identify and consider alternatives, use leverage, and execute the choreography of offers and counteroffers, what's invariably called the dance. It would be remiss of me not to spend some time on the strategic aspect of it, how you can use particular skills to your advantage. But for now, back to emotion. Over the past decade, researchers have begun examining how specific emotions, anger, sadness, disappointment, anxiety, envy, excitement, and regret can affect the behavior of negotiators. They've studied the differences between what happens when people simply feel these emotions and what happens when they also express them to the other party through words or actions. In negotiations that are less transactional and involve parties in long-term relationships, your career in serving is a prime example, understanding the role of emotions is even more important than it is in transactional deal-making. I find this area of emotion fascinating, so let's crack on. We all have the ability to regulate how we experience emotions, and specific strategies can help us improve tremendously in that regard. We also have some control over the extent to which we express our feelings. And again, there's specific ways to rein in or indeed emphasize an expression of emotion when doing so may be advantageous. For instance, research shows that feeling or looking anxious results in suboptimal negotiation outcomes. So individuals who are prone to anxiety when brokering a deal can take certain steps both to limit their nervousness and to make it less obvious to their negotiation opponent. Same is true for other emotions. For those who find it of interest and perhaps struggle in these situations, I think it's worth discussing and sharing coping strategies for many of the emotions that people typically feel over the course of a negotiation. Anxiety is most likely to crop up before the process begins or during its early stages. Picture this, you're in with your manager looking to negotiate a salary increase and you're feeling like Eminem in 8 Mile. Your palms are sweaty, knees weak, arms are heavy. Guarantee, 100%, the person on the other side of the table senses that anxiety. So what you don't want is where there's vomit on your sweater already, mom's spaghetti. Your manager is not going to be as concerned with the market trends for DevOps engineers. They're going to be wondering how you managed to throw up on yourself before your scheduled meeting and questioning whether the same thing happens during difficult conversations with customers. In reality, we're prone to experience anger or excitement in the heat of the discussions. And we're most likely to feel disappointment, sadness, or regret in the aftermath. Anxiety is a state of distress in reaction to threatening stimuli, particularly novel situations that have potential for undesirable outcomes. In contrast to anger, which motivates people to escalate conflict, that's the fight part of the fight or flight response, anxiety trips the flight switch and makes people want to exit the scene. Because patience and persistence are often desirable when negotiating, the urge to get out the door quickly is counterproductive. But the negative effects of feeling anxious while negotiating may go further. And that's what I want to go a bit deeper on in the next slide. From what I've witnessed over time, anxious negotiators also develop low aspirations and expectations, which often lead them to make lowball, timid first offers, a behavior that directly predicts poor negotiating outcomes. It's one thing about feeling anxious, but what about when you express that anxiety, making it visibly clear to your counterparts that you're nervous and perhaps vulnerable? Researchers have conducted experiments to explore how anxious people behaved in situations in which they could potentially seek advice from others. They found that relative to people who did not feel anxious, they were less confident, more likely to consult others when making decisions, and less able to discriminate between good and bad advice. In the most relevant of these experiments, they found that anxious participants did not discount advice from someone with a stated conflict of interest, whereas subjects feeling neutral emotions looked upon that advice justifiably skeptically. Think about that one. You're buying a used car. Is the dealer the best person to ask whether you're getting value for money? Research didn't directly address how the subjects would negotiate. However, it suggests that people who express anxiety are more likely to be taken advantage of in a negotiation, especially if the other party senses their distress. Excellent negotiators, on the other hand, they often make their counterparts feel anxious on purpose. I used to love the BBC show Dragon's Den. 6 wealthy investors negotiated with entrepreneurs looking for funding. Not sure if you guys have seen it, do check it out. Before the show, the contestants have named a specific amount of money they wish to get, along with a percentage in the business that the contestant is offering to sell to the investors. They then pitch their ideas in front of a huge television audience and face questions from the investors that are both aggressive, often aggressive, and unnerving. As this is going on, stress-inducing music fills the TV studio. Whole setup isn't just to create drama entertainment for the viewers, it's also intentionally puts pressure on the entrepreneurs. As it's hard for me to say, get out there and learn by doing, get out there and start negotiating, I really recommend getting on YouTube and searching for Dragon's Den or the local title Shark Tank. Check out the experts and see how it's done. The sharks are professional negotiators who want to knock the entrepreneurs off balance so that it'll be easier to take ownership of their good ideas at the lowest price possible. When multiple sharks want to invest, they often drop comments that are intended to make opposing investors anxious too. If you watch the show closely, you'll spot a pattern. The entrepreneurs who seem least rattled by the environmental stressors tend to negotiate the most carefully and deliberately, and more often than not, they strike the best deals. Takeaway from both research and practice is clear. Go out of your way to avoid feeling anxious while negotiating. It's all very well saying it, but how do you manage it? Train, practice, rehearse, and keep sharpening your negotiating skills. Anxiety is often a response to novel stimuli, so the more familiar the stimuli, the more comfortable and the less anxious you will feel. It's why clinicians who treat anxiety disorders often rely on exposure therapy. People who are nervous about flying on airplanes, for instance, they're progressively exposed to the experience. First, getting used to the sights and sounds, then sitting in airliner seats, and ultimately taking flights, with a bit of luck having a trained pilot behind the controls. Another example, a bit closer to home at Servian, is Toastmasters. Experiencing speech anxiety is normal. Nearly everyone gets nervous when they have to give a speech or a presentation, even experienced speakers. The speakers that look relaxed and confident, though, they've simply learned how to handle their anxiety and use it to enhance their performance, and their anxiety is not visible to the audience. More often than not, they've simply just given more speeches and worked out the very same element of control that you can, with a bit of practice, incorporate into your very own negotiation playbook. People enroll in negotiation classes to learn strategies and increase skills. One of the main benefits is the comfort that comes from repeatedly practicing deal-making in simulations and exercises. Negotiation eventually feels more routine, so it's not such an anxiety-inducing experience. Hopefully that's given you a bit of insight into how emotion plays such an important role in the midst of a negotiation. At the same time, you don't discount strategy and tactics. It all comes together into the one package. For that reason, I'm going to regale you with a case study. Something that's close to home, and like what I said, outside the bounds of serving and work, but I think it's still relevant. I've picked a form of negotiation that many of you will have seen or they've been involved with before, some maybe more so than once, and if you haven't yet, you're more than likely going to go through it at some stage down the line. Here we go. Buying a house at auction. I've picked this as a case study because I believe it's easily relatable. It amplifies the fact that negotiation skills aren't just for business people, and it comes in handy in real world situations. It's a personal story that incorporates the right level of strategic thinking and emotional levers that are present throughout a process that we all have some degree of familiarity with. Negotiating for property is serious business, but your chances of getting the best possible deal increase significantly when you arm yourself with sound knowledge and tactics. Towards the end of 2019, we decided the time was right to buy a house in Melbourne. Friends I'd spoken to, they'd spent months upon months looking at properties, going to auctions week in, week out. Personally, I had no intention of wasting weekend after weekend traipsing around Melbourne looking at houses. I wasn't going to do anything rash, but I went in with the intention of coming out on top as early as possible. As far as I'm concerned, being decisive is key to successful negotiation, I don't like wasting my time unnecessarily. From the get-go, one of the most important things you can do to be a confident negotiator is to have all your finances in order. Before entering the process, I was clear with how much we could afford, pre-approval was set up, we knew where we stood. My wife identified a property in Essendon, it was perfect for our family, and we registered our interest with the agent. A confident negotiation comes from knowledge. We understood the true value of the property and what would also motivate the other parties involved in the negotiation. Earlier, I mentioned how in a particular set of tests, participants who could have been described as anxious did not discount advice from someone with a stated conflict of interest. For that very reason, I didn't seek out to build a relationship with the real estate agent. I was perfectly pleasant and friendly. As far as I was concerned, though, their allegiances lay with the seller and getting the owners the highest possible price. If you think about it, in reality, this is quite a transactional negotiation with few opportunities to collaborate to create value. It's quite different to some of the more long-standing relationships we tend to build up here at Servium. I attended a couple of auctions beforehand, looking to get a sense of what to expect on the day. I wanted to observe the dynamic of the auction. If it was scheduled to start at 2, how long before the bids began to fly? I set myself a challenge of seeing, could I work out who the actual bidders in the auction would be rather than simply interested neighbors? I wanted to see where the actual bidders would typically stand, who they were, who were they with, how they presented themselves, how emotionally invested and animated they were in proceeding through the process. What did I learn? Invariably, the person with the most money won out and got the keys. And that's the reality. I knew I'd be as well prepared as anyone present with the strategy to match. I knew my limit though, and the fact was that if someone else went over my limit, game over, I was out. In any negotiation, sound knowledge and tactics are the cornerstone to coming out on top. At the same time, sometimes things are just out of your hands. We could be negotiating a deal with Servium. I may have surrounded myself with all the right people here. Our offer may be the most compelling, but the decision maker could be best of mates with our competitor, has an allegiance with them, and just simply gives them the business. These things simply happen and you just have to live with it. All you can do in as many ways as possible is just try and stack the odds in your favor. Final thing I did prior to the auction was sit down with two auctioneers. One was a friend of a friend, the other a neighbor. Bounced a number of ideas off the two lads and as best as I could, worked out my strategy for the day. Coupled with that, I got an important piece of information. One of the auctioneers knew the agent selling the house on the day. They weren't best of mates. They weren't going to reveal an inside track. When I say an inside track, I wasn't going to hear that, let's say, the couple was going through a divorce and are looking to sell as quickly as possible, just as an example. But they had enough of a business relationship for the selling agent to reveal that he expected 3 interested parties to be present on the day. Taking that I was one of those interested parties, that was good information to have. Had I heard there were several parties, I'd probably have had more reservations about my chance of success. Again, wasn't groundbreaking information I just got my hands on, but it's just something else I can add to the jigsaw. Another piece of information that I've got in my back pocket. The more insights that you're privy to, the stronger your position. When you're negotiating, know as much as you can about the other parties. If I'm selling on behalf of Servium, I need to understand our competitor's approach. It's no different than when you're looking to buy a house. Let's get more into it. In a minute, I'll provide you with a powerful framework that'll help you view each negotiation more analytically, suit you guys down to the ground. First, I'll be upfront and I'll let you in on the figures I was looking at on the day. Otherwise, I'm really just skirting around the details. The guide price on the day was close to 1.7 million. It was late in 2019 and there was a bit of heat in the market. My auctioneer friend told me he saw it going for around the 1.8 million mark and above. Myself and my wife, we agreed at a price at which we'd walk away, and that was 1.75 million. I'm revealing these figures because they need to be part of your strategy, and I'll tell you why they're important. Before entering a negotiation, you need to assess 3 things. your goals, your best alternative to a negotiated agreement, it's your BATNA, and the reservation price. The goals should be quantitative and precise. As the negotiator, you are held accountable for them. A caveat is that reaching a fair agreement, that is not a goal. There is no such thing as dividing the pie fairly, because fairness is not an objective measure. In the instance of the house, my goal was to buy the house for the cheapest possible price. BATNA is the alternative to the deal if you cannot come to an agreement. The reservation price is the walkaway point that you will not breach and which you cannot reveal at any cost. I was willing to walk away at 1.75. The final deal is usually secured between the goal and the reservation price. The bargaining zone is the space between the buyer's and the seller's reservation price. So the zones must overlap for a possible agreement. Let's get to the day of the auction. My first important decision, I decided to go alone. My wife's far smarter than me. She's a much nicer person than I am. But I had a worry that in this situation, she'd struggle to contain her emotional investment in the process. I'll give you an example of where I'm coming from with this. Let's say the competition is heating up and we're getting closer to our reservation price, the price at which we're going to walk away. You don't reveal that price, nor do you want to give visible emotional cues that you're reaching that point, something which a savvy negotiator can prey upon. Luckily, my wife had the same concerns as I did, and she was happy to leave me to it. Auctions are a hotbed of emotion. You go to one, glances are exchanged between groups, people attempting to discern between serious bidders or curious neighbors, competitors or spectators. Coupled with that, there's a heightened sense of occasion and anticipation, which in turn is ramped up by the auctioneer and their hammer, playing the pressure-inducing role of a countdown clock. I'd like to think I'm fairly jovial and open book, but sometimes you just got to put on a game face. In my case, it's not the prettiest of faces, but I brought it to the auction. Obviously, my wife wasn't there, neither were my three kids. Again, it's part of the negotiation tactic. You just make it hard for others to label you. You arrive on your own. None of the other potential buyers know your motivation. Are you buying? Are you investing? Are you looking to develop? No one was any the wiser, and that's how I wanted it. I arrive with three kids, and they'd correctly assume I'm looking to buy into the school zone. It's the small things. Think about it. It's October. The new school year is a few short months away. I don't want anyone thinking, this guy's under a bit of pressure to get into the zone. He's ripe to be squeezed. I arrive a few minutes before I introduce myself to the agent. I decide against taking a brochure. You just want to radiate confidence and assuredness during a negotiation. You see people nervously flicking through the brochure. It's pointless. It's just a crutch, and I didn't need it. I had a black sporty type jacket on. I wore a pair of shorts. Why? I got lovely legs. Now, I just like that more comfortable, physical, sporty look, that I was there for some competition, that I was there to win. Auction commenced at about 12:40 on the day. We found out what a wonderful neighborhood it was, the lovely family that owned the house, and all that good stuff. You hear that at auctions all the time. Auctioneer did a song and dance routine before finally leading with a vendor bid of 1.68 million, looking to kick off proceedings. He looked at the crowd, seeing who wanted to raise that by a figure of $10,000. Do we have an offer of 1.69? Nothing. Sound of silence. The auctioneer's dance continued. He was like Harold Ziegler in Moulin Rouge. This guy was all charisma. Nothing. He stretched it out for a few short minutes. And with that, he went inside. I'd seen this before at a previous auction. And I knew that it's simply a case of just pausing for breath. People just get ready for the music to restart. Noel was the auctioneer's name. He came out, and again, he mentioned the vendor's bid of 1.68 million. He explained that by rising that figure by $10,000, you would have the opportunity to go inside and negotiate directly with the owner. Otherwise, the action would take place outside or over the coming days. Nothing. And then he changed his tune. Rather than $10,000 to generate the right level of interest, let's start with $5,000. So for an additional $5,000, you had the opportunity to go inside. That was my cue. I put my hand up. I locked eyes with the auctioneers. I acknowledged the offer with a nod of the head. I took good care of my physical appearance. I didn't look around. I didn't fidget. I looked confident. It's all part and parcel of negotiation. Don't drop your guard. Look the part. Auctioneer continued his song and dance routine. It was open to the others to raise my offer. Otherwise, I would be the person going inside to negotiate further. Noel continued his theatrics, incorporating the going once, going twice routine, trying to solicit a competing bid. Was I nervous? Fucking right, I was nervous. As it happens, I was standing a few steps in front of everyone. I was on the road, standing beside a parked car, while everyone else was on the path behind. I hadn't seen the reaction to my bid. I purposefully hadn't looked in their direction, but I knew that right now, I was the center of attention. I kept eye contact with the auctioneer, kept my confident look, betraying what was actually going on inside my head. It's all part of the negotiation. Look like you're in control. Keep the game face. Limit your nervousness, make it less obvious to your negotiation opponent, and you'll come out on top far more often. Anyway, I can't see the others. I'm fixated on Noel, and he's going once, he's going twice. He's going so bloody slow, and I'm wishing he'll stop. At the same time to the others, I'm looking rock solid in command. It's all part of the game. Gone. And with that, he's done. I'm through to the next round. Now, a quick point on pressure tactics in negotiation. Depends on how long you've been at Servian, but within reason, it's fair to say that you've got a certain amount of relationship capital with certain individuals within the organization. If you're negotiating a change of engagement, a pay rise, a promotion, extended leave, it's in your best interest to retain that relationship capital. You damage that relationship by looking to forcibly dictate the terms, that capital gets depleted. Pay me an extra 15K or I'm out of here. I want to get off this engagement by the end of the week. Or I'm going to Europe for 6 weeks. Take it or leave it. Damien Cooch will tell you, I've started with that much relationship capital with him. It's long since gone and we're currently in negative figures. You make ultimatums like that, resentment sets in, negative emotions start to fester, and there's a good chance you don't come to an optimal outcome. Reason I bring it up is this, and coming back to the auction. I read somewhere that in the event of being invited inside to negotiate with the vendor, you simply decline and ask to continue the negotiation from the front garden. Why, you ask? There's reasoning to it that makes sense. The idea is that by negotiating from the front garden, you have full visibility of which of your competitors remain. And should they depart over the course of the next 5, 10, 15 minutes, your negotiating strategy could potentially encompass the fact that you're the only one bidding in an attempt to bring down the price. It's extreme, but it's plausible. I asked my auctioneer friend about this possible strategy prior to the auction. They'd never heard of it before, but as they thought about it, they suggested ditching that idea. Why? It's a pressure tactic. It's me dictating what will be seen as an uncomfortable environment, possibly leading to that resentment. It's that relationship capital becoming depleted. There's nothing stopping the vendors thinking, nah, this guy's a dick. Let's play hardball, get him out of our house, and we'll try and sell this house again in a few weeks. Right, let's go inside. I took a seat. I mentioned earlier that before entering a negotiation, you need to assess three things. Your goals, your best alternative to a negotiated agreement, that's the BATNA, and the reservation price. My goal, to get the house for as cheaply as possible. My BATNA, the best alternative to a negotiated agreement, that's the process that we were currently in. The reservation price, 1.75, the price at which I would walk away. The auctioneer and his assistant sat me in the living room at the front of the house. The vendor was in another room. Thing is, I knew I was in a strong position. I was surprised at the lack of a competing bid and the fact that I was negotiating at the current price. Nolan and his assistant, they came back. He explained how the vendor was keen on doing a deal today, but they couldn't accept 1685. This stage is interesting from a negotiating point of view. Noel had made an open-ended statement. He hadn't told me what the vendor was willing to accept, nor had he asked me what I was willing to pay. There's an inherent ambiguity in most negotiations. Some experts suggest that you should wait for the other side to speak first. If the vendor states what's acceptable, the argument goes you'll gain valuable information about their bargaining position and clues about acceptable agreements. This advice makes intuitive sense, but it fails to account for the powerful effect that first offers have on the way people think about the negotiation process. Substantial psychological research suggests that more often than not, negotiators who make first offers come out ahead. In this instance, my strategy was to go with the former, seeing what they thought would be acceptable. I asked the question, and I was told that they were looking at closer to 1.75. In my mind, I'm thinking, fantastic. I didn't expect to be in this position at our first auction. They've given me a figure that's essentially my reservation price, the figure at which I would have walked away. We had presumed it was going to go for a lot more, but that's not the point. Right now, we were nicely within our budget. Anyway, there was still a $65,000 difference between what they were looking for and where my offer stood. Back to pressure tactics. 1685, that's my final offer. Take it or leave it. There's nothing stopping me taking that approach. It's high risk, but I could do it. I could say that's the maximum finance that I was able to get. Think about it though. It's like negotiating a salary increase. If you don't pay me this, I'm leaving. Let's say you enjoy the job that you're in. You're having a great time at Servia, and you would happily take, truth be told, a reduced figure. Your gamble may pay off, but what if it doesn't? How do you rectify this situation without losing face? It's really hard. In both scenarios, depending on the situation, there's a high likelihood that the relationship capital that you had may be depleted. And the thing is, I knew I was in a fantastic position to get this house. Why would I look to torpedo my position? So I told the auctioneer I'd be ready to go to 1.7. Perhaps I could have gone up in smaller increments, but I was comfortable with this figure. They left the room, spoke to the vendor, and came back quite quickly. The vendor was looking for 1.74. Back to emotions. At this stage, I was a lot calmer than how I'd felt outside on the street. We have some control over the extent to which we express our feelings. Don't get flustered, keep calm, stay in control. I knew at this stage that I was going to get the house. We were that close to the finishing line. It was just a question of closing out the buying price. I explained I was at my limit, but I could go to 1.71. Noel left, he came quickly back, and he said the vendor would accept 1.2. House would be mine. Everyone likes to think that they've had the final say, and I was no different. I said that if they were happy to meet me in the middle, I'd buy the house at 1.7, 1715. He came back and we had a deal. And I had a big mortgage. Right, let's wrap this up. In summary, negotiating requires some of the same skills that playing poker does. A strategic focus, a knack for assessing odds, reading people, understanding others' positions, and bluffing when necessary. You can learn a crucial lesson from the card table, the value of controlling the emotions we feel, and especially those that we reveal. In other words, good negotiators need to develop a poker face. Not one that remains expressionless, always hiding true feelings, but one that displays the right emotions at the right times. To be a better deal maker, conduct a thorough assessment of which emotions you are particularly prone to feel before, during, and after negotiations, and use techniques to minimize or maximize the experience and suppress or emphasize the expression of emotions as needed. We'll finish off with two quotes. I'll leave you to read the two. The second one is from Victor Kiam. He was the CEO of Remington. And he had a great catchphrase he used to use on his ads in the late 70s and 80s. Oh, I like the shaver so much I bought the company. The guy's a legend. Sorry, all that shows you is how old I am. Hopefully you'll have got some value from this. Like I always say, I'm more than happy to chat through any aspects of what I've presented. Do drop me a line or give me a call. Cheers.